Imagine a world with no cold calling. A world where companies don't sell your data to other companies who want to pester you. At G4 Claims, we don't cold call and we don't buy a single lead from data companies. Oh, and if you're due any compensation from your car accident, you pay nothing to us at all. For full accident management support, including motor replacement, repairs and personal injury compensation claims, just search G4 Claims today. For help the way you want it.
Right, what's happening, people? Welcome back
to
another episode of TSF Talk Scottish Football.
72,
episode 72. You've been here for the start.
I've not been on since 42.
Well, let's address this then. There was rumours that you'd moved back home. You were starting up a small, what was it, Avon business or something like that?
Nice.
Somebody else came up with a theory that you're leaving us for another podcast. Tell the people the truth, because there was a lot of comments last week in regards to your absence.
Yeah.
What's happening? Where have you been?
I don't know how to put it down as. I think some people were quite happy I was gone, though. I was quite hurt a little bit, to be honest. Some of the comments were a bit rude, actually. Do you think so?
No, I thought they were amazing. Last week
people started to miss me. The week before, I was getting a bit of stick. No, I'm just a busy boy, you know. I'm working all the time, slaving away, grafting. Not just at work. I'm joking.
My man.
I've missed it. I've not been here.
We've missed you as well.
And people have missed you. The views are fucking flying.
The views are flying. That's last week without a thumbnail as well. Ryan, if you could address that quickly, that'd be great.
And also, another thing. As of last night, we were 43 subs off 5,000. So, you know, if you're new, drop a wee sub and get us to 5K.
Yes, we're also joined by Jackie Robertson, fresh.
Fresh. That's not a word I would have used.
What time did you get in it this morning, Jack?
Oh,
well, to your bed. What time did you?
Oh, what time I go to bed at?
About 6-ish.
About half six.
But it's currently 20 past 10.
We picked him up about
fresh.
It was actually great. Like, I says to Davey, let me phone him, because he's no read any of the messages or anything like that in the group chat. I wasn't expecting him to answer, but he answers on about the fifth ring.
Hello. So
I thought we were picking up fucking Edith from Still Game when he answered the phone this morning.
Hello.
Your voice was away with the fairies.
I don't know what you've done to recover since then, because I thought you were in a bit of trouble when we phoned you. I was like, there's no way.
Mate, I bounced up, gave myself a wee slap. Cold water in the face, and I was like, right.
Looked yourself in the mirror and said, Jack, come on,
I'm ready,
you're better than this, and then you sort yourself out. Fair play, because half the other cunts in TSF chat, fuck me, try to get them out today. It's impossible.
Blood out of a stone, innit?
I know.
I'm still a bit half cut, to be fair.
I'll make it for a better show, though.
Well, indeed, we've got a lot to get through.
We do indeed.
And we were hoping that one of our, well, Celtic fan kind of pundits would be able to
I can play the character.
I'm very surprised that none of them are here.
Yeah.
Considering
they were here yesterday, weren't they, on the Celtic Thunder, also brought to you by TSF.
Talking absolute shite about the fucking resurrection of Christ.
It was actually quite good, because Ryan actually changed all of these buttons.
Nice.
And he changed it like an Ange Postecoglou tune and all that.
Right, okay.
And so he was playing that, and then there was a Rangers podcast in later that night, Battle Fever podcast. So he's doing his sound checks and all that, and he presses it, and then the grand old team starts playing. So he grassed Ryan into the studio manager, so apologies to the Battle Fever podcast for Ryan's behaviour there.
Did he grass him in?
He grassed him in, and he's also...
It's
a joke. He was taking it well, but as a joke back to Ryan, he's changed the buttons to red, white and blue, so...
What's the sounds?
It's the same sound.
I'm actually disappointed, because they had Let's Go and all that on it, but this week you've just got your old...
The classics. It's a nice colour sequence as well.
Just get the classics, so we have, boys.
So, where should we kick off? I mean, we could kick off in two different places, because obviously there was two big stories at the weekend. I think we'll start with you lot, shall we, since you were first. And since you two are here to answer the...
Talk about Rangers then.
Yeah.
It was Rangers 0.
Dundee United 1.
This was a team that I thought weren't going to do bits this season. And I still don't think that they're going to do...
Neither do they.
Don't think they're going to go in, though.
I think they'll do alright, actually.
If they keep putting in performances like they did versus Rangers, then they'll be alright, won't they? Because I thought especially the first 5-10 minutes, they were right in Rangers' fate.
I think
the full game, right? But see, the first 10 minutes kind of hits you a wee bit more, because I think they get the first cut of corners.
Aye.
They were putting the pressure on Rangers. It was a start that I don't think any has kind of foreseen happening. And you've got to, firstly, before talking about Rangers and their poor performance, you've got to give credit to to Coates, the manager, who was under a lot of criticism, changed it up in the game, changed the formation. I think it caught Rangers by surprise. They got in Rangers' faces. A lot of players that I thought wouldn't kind of make the grade this season were really good, mm-hmm. the midfield especially. And that's where Rangers are really strong. So firstly, you need to give credit to them.
Yeah, absolutely. And the most mental thing is, I think I always say this about Rangers, if you can get through the first 15, 20 minutes against Rangers, you need to do that if you're going to have any chance. Because mm-hmm. Rangers start so fast. You saw it against Livingston. They were unbelievable for about 20, 25 minutes, then foot off the boil, and because they didn't really need to. But you see Rangers do that a lot. They manage games so well. But United got through that. They didn't just get through the opening exchanges. They more than competed. As you said, I think the most impressive thing from them was their intensity. And I think a lot of people thought, they're not going to keep this up.
I see what I thought.
But they did. They managed to keep it up for large parts of the game. And then they get their goal. And once you've got something like that to defend, it's pretty easy for them. They sort it out really well.
That was like the main thing I was saying to my mate. I was like, they kept it up the whole 90 minutes. Like, if you look at the highlights and you look at like the last 10, 15 minutes, they're in every single player's face as soon as they get the ball. And that's the kind of pressure you need to defend that 1-0 win. And I was one of the ones where last season, we had a couple of their games, but we got the goal and we snuck a goal. That's why we went obviously unbeaten. But that's the kind of game last season we managed to get in the lane. But that just didn't work out for us that day.
Just to get back to Dundee United quickly, I was really impressed with our will to win. For a Rangers fans' point of view, it's disappointing that the unbeaten run goes in that fashion. But they, for me, had the like more will to win than Rangers.
Definitely.
And to go back to their press, it was just so I was impressed by their press.
I think the fans really helped them a lot, though. It was a big boost for Dundee United having their own supporters. There were good atmosphere up at Tannadice, and it just gives you that extra yard. I think a lot of people think about crowds and how they help you when you're going forward, but see when you're trying to keep a team out, they can make a world of difference. And I think it did. It inspired them. And there's been a lot of like unsettled sort of supporters at Dundee United. They're not very happy with the appointment. They're not happy with a lot of things. But, you know, if the team can give them that, like the team gave them something to cheer about, and in return the fans gave back.
A Dundee United last season, when their fans tried to hold on to a 1-0 win for half an hour, would have been a lot harder.
Well, I mean, look at the Celtic game early on in the season last year. They didn't hold on there, they got beat by Rangers up there as well. You know, so I think it's a good point. I think they definitely made a difference.
Through the years, Tannadice has been a tough place to go as well. And then if you go back to the performances of Rangers last season up there, it was a tough game. It took Tavernier exceptional free kick and a good finish for Goldson to kind of take the points home. So it was always going to be a tough game, but I don't think a lot of people kind of seen that one coming. So on Dundee United then, who were the players that impressed you guys?
Ryan first Edwards for me.
Edwards.
Oh, at the bat, he won everything. So I listened to the first half on the radio and watched the second half on my phone. And everything in the first half was Ryan Edwards heads it away. He just headed everything away. Mulgrew, I thought, was good as well. Fuchs in midfield was brilliant.
There was a wee player, I don't know his name, he's got blonde hair though, and there was a post on Instagram, and it was that Mad Many Men song. And it was like him making like four tackles, like many men love upon me. I was like,
I can't even think who that would have been.
Camden.
But they were all at it. They were just so well drilled, and it was a good
performance.
So
organised.
And then Robson gets the goal. May or may not be leaving them. Same with Lauren Shanklin. May or may not be leaving. Sounds like he is leaving Lauren Shanklin.
But where's he gone?
Some Belgian team, was it Bearshot or something like that?
I think he's going somewhere for 500 G's.
No, it's a million quid.
Is it a million?
It's a million
quid.
Sorry. But I'm still, I don't think that's been confirmed yet. It sounds like it was set to happen. I heard a lot of talk last week that both Edinburgh clubs were interested in bringing Shanklin to the capital.
I'm surprised he's not staying in Britain, really.
I mean, if you're
Hibs, money in
if you're, I mean, if Nesbitt was away, I think Hibs would go for him. But I don't think Nesbitt's going now. So, but then, I mean, Hearts have got Liam Boyce, so. Do they need them? I don't know. But I definitely think it'd be a good signing for either one of those two. But I think he's not got long left of his contract. But a million quid's good business.
That's
for but they probably could have got more year ago.
Wait, see, he's
25, 26, 27.
He's getting on a bit. He's been a bit for a while, to be fair. So he has. On Rangers then, Jack, where did it go wrong?
Where did it go not wrong?
Where did it go right? That's probably an easier one to answer.
This is the thing. See, when I seen the team, I was like, that's the kind of team I want to see. I don't know about you, but Lundstrom for me hasn't really hit the mark. I mean, I think he might come into a game. But even just watching it, 1-0 down. 1-0 down, I just didn't feel... same with Malmo, even though we did score, I just never seen us getting a goal. I was like, we could have played here all week, not got a goal. The passing was a bit sluggish. 1-0 down at Tannadice, I'm expecting a lot faster pace, and it just didn't seem like they were there. Like the corner, Goldson's chance, see the corner, like literally just skips by the post. Mm-hmm. I felt like that had to go in for us to get the draw that day. As soon as he missed that, I just kind of sat back in my chair.
I've seen a lot of reactions from Rangers fans at the weekend. I think first of all, to a lot of them on Twitter, calm down. It would be the big thing I would say to them. Like, there's a lot of overreaction to this, and I think a lot of it comes from there's a generation of Rangers supporters here that are used to them being struggling and being shit, and they've only just got the taste of success again. Do you know what I mean? Like, they're panicking. I think if they lose one game, everyone's thinking the wheels are going to... I think generally people think the wheels are going to come off. No, it's a lot of nonsense chat on Twitter.
See, for me, honestly, Twitter world is not real life, lads. No. It just really isn't. It's not a true reflection on how the actual feeling is within anything. Do you know what I mean? It's always over-exaggerated and all the rest of it. So for the outside looking in, people are seeing tweets with a lot of likes and a lot of retweets, and they're assuming that fucking the majority of Rangers fans
he's got it back again. Look, he's got his own style shit. When he's in here.
He loves it.
It's just easier.
It's
just easier.
Heavy
though.
That's his thing with him, so you'd be alright with that.
I used to, mate.
But see, just own that. Panic stations, people that are panicking and all that sort of stuff, I think they need to calm down a wee bit. We're recording this before the Malmo game, so my opinion might change the next. We'll not touch on the Malmo game too much. Maybe we do a show later on, end of the week or something like that.
We might need to do a...
to react to that, because you've got the big game coming up too.
We'll need to do a preview for Friday, won't we?
So maybe if you smash the like button, get involved in the comments, we do a wee live show. Panic stations for me need to chill out. Like, as you said, Jack, Rangers had performances like this last season.
Yes.
The ones that stick to mind where Rangers shouldn't have won the match or had a point at the match was probably Hamilton away, who were the worst team in the country.
They
you
were
could
brilliant
say
that day, though.
They were excellent that day. They deserved all 3 points, but Rangers managed to get a goal and then they got a point at the game. So that's a game that could have went the other way. There was the Motherwell results too. What is it? One each away from home. Big Cedric Eaton, I'm sure, scored.
3-1.
I remember Hibs at home dominated Rangers. They win 1-0. So sometimes in football, these things happen.
Mate, Celtic played us better than us. That
aye, Celtic as well. Celtic dominated Rangers as well. At Ibrox, and you still win the game. So it's all about that 3 points. And obviously it does sting because you were on such a like an unbeaten record, and there was a lot made out of it and stuff. But this happens. Like, when I look at the game, yes, Dundee United had a good press and all that, but they didn't necessarily break Rangers down. Yeah. They didn't come there and dominate Rangers and unearth vulnerabilities in that back line. For me personally, if you look at the goal, it's a deflection.
Goal, it's a bad goal to concede, isn't it?
Well, it's a slice of luck as well. It's a positive run for Robson. Lundstrom lets him run. He gets a break of the ball, and it's a great finish. Mm. Do you know what I mean? And sometimes this happens. So when you're actually talking about the shape of Rangers and all that sort of stuff, nothing really needs to change. Nothing was necessarily exposed, in my opinion. But the Rangers players still need to get through the levels.
Yeah, the thing that I think the biggest problem for Rangers was, and Jack mentioned it, was a lack of intensity, and they couldn't match the intensity that Dundee United were bringing. I think you can cut down any game of football, and if it comes back to the fact that one team's hungry and one team's fighting for a result more, they're probably going to get it. But I mean, the one thing I will say about Gerrard is that he will be absolutely fizzing. You could see it the weekend, and I think he's got a ruthless streak. I think that if players are not performing to the level that he expects, he'll bomb them if he has to. He'll chuck them out of the team. So, and there's also competition. We've got to remember how good Rangers' squad is. Also, I mean, you've got Morelos, who's just not long back. Barisic is not long back. You know, Morelos, I can understand why he played him, but I don't think he wasn't 100%, obviously. Yeah. He's been stuck in a hotel room for God knows how long.
Jogging about in a car park.
So. But again, and it was something someone said on the radio, actually, you can understand why he played him, because he's just so much better than the rest of... I don't care how good Sakal has been or how good Etienne can be. Morelos is so clear of the three of them. So he has to be fit and firing, especially for tonight's game. So, I don't think Rangers should worry too much. You know, I think the fact that both Celtic and Rangers have already dropped points this season kind of shows the season that I think it's going to be. It'll be a lot more close than it was last year. I think Rangers will drop more points this season. I think they'll lose more games this season. And Celtic will as well. So,
On Friday, though.
They're not going to drop points on Friday because it's a cup game.
You said lose a game.
Jack, it's not ideal preparation for this massive game versus Malmo. Let's not talk too much about the game because obviously we don't know the result and what's happened.
Well done, Rangers, and we should do... That was a fucking disaster.
It was brilliant for Rangers. Stephen Davis hat trick, lovely for him.
What a disaster. What is it Malmo have got with pumping Scottish teams? It's a disaster. Hold on a minute here. Can we talk about the manager?
Oh my God.
The Malmo manager. Can we talk about that? Have you seen that?
CK bastard.
He's a wee
So, What's the script there? What's his problem?
Seeing it in the game, right? Malmo were the last team that Rangers played in the Champions League.
Right.
So their fans and their manager and their media have made a thing out of this match in terms of making it some sort of rivalry that there's something in it. Aye. For Rangers, it means absolutely jack shit. Malmo is a football
there
club.
There are stepping stones.
Exactly. I mean, when they say that pump, too soon, in case they pump Hibs
8-0 Easter Road. Aye.
But they've made it something that it's not. I don't think that the comments are just necessary.
It's just a Celtic dad, isn't he, that guy? It's fucking brilliant.
It's
I love that.
It's the facial expressions, like, as if he's like, oh, these cunts.
I know, but I mean, he's just trying to add a bit of a needle to the tie. I mean, they've got the lead, to be fair to them. They're coming here, and if they can wind up Rangers, then...
Do you know, Hank, it's a bit like he's using excuses early. He's like, oh, Rangers are the favourites. We're going to win the back. I would get it, mate. Like,
it's mind games for the manager,
you're winning 2-1.
Fair play to him for that. He's starting to rile up the supporters. He's trying.
He's what?
But I don't know if that'll... I don't know if that'll be good for his team or no.
Well, again, it comes back to what I said about Saturday. If they can get through the opening half hour or so... And then frustrate Rangers, the crowd will get frustrated.
Right, but obviously we can't talk too much about the game because this will be out after the actual game. So, Jack, I need to ask you, to a Rangers fan, how important is the Champions League? You know, how much does it mean to the Rangers fans and such?
Oh my God, man. Like, I remember going to my first Champions League game and it was like just different class. See when you hear that music through the stadium, you get that feel. It's the peak of football when you go to a Champions League game. I think my first one was... It was the year we were playing Bursaspor, Valencia, and Man U. I can't remember who, what order we played them in. But we got a draw against Valencia, and I think it was Edu that scored. And it was like, I celebrated like an old firm. It was like that big a deal. I think Edu like took out.
Edu was man of the match for both teams that game. He scored an own goal as well.
He got took out when he scored and all. But it's unbelievable. See just the whole atmosphere, the feeling going to the game under the lights, you hear the music. Oh, it's a different class, man.
Aye, absolutely. Absolutely.
Like, the money's well,
isn't it? Aye, money's a massive factor. Let's move on now to the title of this video. We had different ideas for a title, you know.
We were all in agreement on one thing, though.
Exactly. As soon as Kyogo
Furuhashi
scored a hat-trick at the weekend and it got put on the SPFL
second
YouTube
second trending on YouTube.
Literally, mate.
Second
you continue on Furuhashi and I'll check it.
On who?
On Kyogo.
Furuhashi.
And I'll something.
Even Jack loves him. He's singing a song about him already.
See the thing is, right? The song's class. The song is class. But it's Halliday.
Before I wax lyrical about Kyogo, I want to caveat it by saying one thing. Dundee United were fucking horrendous. Woefully bad. But anyway, you can only beat what's in front of you, and Celtic did that with style.
Six gone on 12.
Ryan Christie was phenomenal. I mean, the two assists from Ryan Christie were just unbelievable.
And he got three overall?
Yeah, did he get three? There was two in particular that were fantastic. The one where he beats the man down the left and puts a wonderful cross into Kyogo, and the second one...
Has he got a new contract yet?
Not yet. I'm sure... I mean, I'm still a little bit confused about this. I've heard that his contract's up...
Is it January?
In January, but I don't know if that's actually been confirmed by the club or not, so we'll need to see. But I think he might sign a new one now. Ange is obviously desperate to keep him. And why not? I said this a lot last year... When Celtic fans were criticising him, that with a decent coach and finding a bit of form, he'd be a player again, because he's no doubt his ability. But the two assists were phenomenal. The way to pass for the hat-trick goal is just phenomenal. But a lot of that comes down to the movement of Kyogo, and that's one of the most impressive things about him, was his movement without the ball. Making runs, dropping into pockets, and, you know, we talked about it in the bit in the car. I don't think he's a phenomenal finisher, but the positions he gets himself in, he's going to score a lot of goals. And yeah, perfect for Celtic. They did look a lot better, but again, Dundee were hopeless. But there's lots. There is lots to be positive about if you're a Celtic fan looking at that. Yeah. Lots to be positive about.
The goal that really stood out for me for Kyogo was the one which Celtic do get down the left hand side, and he makes a kind of darting run towards the front post, takes the defender away, and then changes direction really quickly.
Classic, isn't it?
Class movement for him, and then the finish. That was the one that really stood out. For me, he's got really, really good movement. He's missed a couple of chances as well, but he's getting himself into the positions. And if you're scoring three goals or two goals and a goal every other game, Celtic fans, they won't really care. He's missing some chances.
That's exactly what Celtic are wanting. See, Edward, he's a kind of player that will take it in and play a wee passive football. See the person, he never, I didn't watch the whole game, but he did not stop. See if you see the player that's going to make that run, going to get in that position, that's the player that they've been needing.
Yeah.
And it's been proved that he's scored a hat-trick.
I think Edward had a lot of criticism, and he's been, in fairness, he's been absolutely miles off it. But the biggest thing for me about him just now is that he always wants the ball to feet Edward, and he's always dropping too far deep. You've got to change it up at times. Kyogo does, he's really good at stretching the defence, and he's got a good bit of pace over 5 yards, and you know, not just that, I mean, Abada's doing really well. He's coming, he looks a decent player. He's causing, you know, them problems. I think a lot of people worried about how Celtic were going to do in the final third of the attacking three. Obviously, if Edward's going to be away, Ayeti's not really up to it. Forrest's had his injuries, Johnson's had his injuries. But now, I mean, at the moment, Christie, Kyogo and Abada's a front three. They look pretty good. Forrest's still there, obviously. So, yeah, lots for them to be happy about. Stephen Welsh coming back in was a good thing as well, because Speeton's fucking hopeless. So, I mean, I'm not a massive Stephen Welsh fan. I don't think he's anywhere near as good as some people do, but he's done well, to be fair to him, and he did well again at the weekend. But
just to go back to the boy Kyogo, then, the thing that I saw last night, right, obviously it was number one trending. It was number one trending in the UK. It was ahead
second
of
worldwide, was it
was ahead of Guardian Football, right? The title was Lionel Messi gives kind of heartfelt speech in his final farewell to Barcelona. That was one of the videos. It was ahead of. It was ahead of the 100 meter final highlights.
Oh, really?
It was ahead of a
how can you do highlights of a 100 meters final? It lasts fucking 10 seconds.
Exactly. It was ahead of a Mr. Beast video, and it was ahead of a Sidemen Sunday. So this video was absolutely flying, and
Dundee fans must like getting beaten.
No, it's crazy because I always watch the highlights on the SBFL YouTube channel, and you kind of get used to the views and all that sort of stuff, what happens, and this is unheard of.
So now we're trying to step into the Japanese market.
Yep.
So
we are.
But also another wee
Ichiban,
thing
about lipstick for men.
He is. What?
I don't know. It's a friend's quote. Somebody please tell me you get
So another thing about him, he's just the most wholesome human being ever. Did you see him when he got the man of the match?
He is
so wholesome. When he got the man of the match, he's like bowing and he's clapping away. And then full time he goes round and he like singles out every player for like just
he's the kind of player that if he's at your team, you love him.
Most people will love him, but you lot are probably not.
Before we go on to another positive for Celtic fans, potentially, in Tony Ralston. There's something. He's got to be the starter for the next 10 years at Celtic. But listen, fair play to him, because to be an old fun player, you need to come through a lot of criticism, and he's done that, and he scored a couple of goals. He took his goal really, really well.
He did. He got a bit lucky with the first touch, though, because it kind of bobbled off. The second was a lovely touch and a good finish.
And he's been a player that's been under a lot of criticism.
His goal against Hearts was class as well, to be fair to him.
Fair play to him.
His goal against Hearts was very good.
But this is the problem. And you mentioned earlier about Twitter not being the real world. There are now people on Twitter saying that Tony Ralston is good enough to play for Celtic. I'm sorry, I don't give a shit if he scored two goals and had a couple of decent performances. And it's something I said last season. Everyone, like Celtic fans, are moaning about the board standards dropping, Lennon standards dropping. Subsequently, fan standards have dropped as well, because Celtic are in a position where you've got people there who genuinely think that they can play Tony Ralston and Stephen Welsh as part of the back four and still win a league title.
Although I think the two players have probably showed up, they could play.
Stephen Welsh is more than good enough to be a squad player for Celtic now. I think he's done well.
I agree.
But he's also done that now over 3, 4, 5 months. You know, Tony Ralston 2 weeks ago was the worst player ever to play for Celtic, according to some. Yeah. And now he's good enough to be the backup. You know, that doesn't change that quickly. You know, you can have a couple of good games, but you know, he needs a bit of consistency. He's going to have to be the backup, or maybe even the first teamer, because Celtic are not recruiting right backs. He even talked last night, they're going for a striker for £7 million.
Jeez, oh.
Buy a fucking right back, dearie me.
Shoot up the defence first before you kind of move on. Like, the other, I wanted to go to Tony Ralston after this because it might be seen as a kind of more negative look on it, but it's something that just came to mind, and yous might completely disagree for me here. But see, David Turnbull, I thought he had a decent game versus Dundee, right?
About time, because he's been hopeless recently.
Yeah, but see if you look at the kind of style of player that Ange Postecoglou has got, and he seems to go for, like Kyogo. He's all about energy and getting your face and pressing. Christie's the perfect player for him. Does David Turnbull fit into that system for you?
Even though
he doesn't really have that style.
I think he's got a bit of running about him. I think
There's always a lot of press about him being subbed after 70 minutes and stuff like that.
Yeah, but I don't always. Sometimes I saw that happen and I didn't always think it was warranted. Yeah, I think it was just somebody's got to get subbed. The one thing about Turnbull is he's not been in good form, so that's probably why a lot of people are questioning him just now, and I understand that. I mean, me and you got a bit of stick last season for saying that we thought he was off the boil towards the end, and I still stand by that now, and it continued into the start of this season. He seems to have hit his groove again at the weekend. No doubt a phenomenal player, a phenomenal talent for this league. But yeah, it's an interesting one. I think Cal McGregor has found a bit of form again.
Because he's a perfect player for this system.
Yeah, and it will suit Turnbull as well. The problem they're going to have, and I think McCarthy might be the solution to it, is you don't want, the worst thing you can do about Cal McGregor, and he had to do it a lot with Scott Brown, was he ended up being Scott Brown's legs last season, and it restricts so much of what he's got going forward. Mm-hmm. I think if you've got McCarthy at the base of that midfield with Turnbull and McGregor ahead, I think it's a nice balance. And then until you see that team kind of as it's, you know, when everyone's fit and playing, it's kind of hard to judge how Turnbull's going to do, but there's no doubt in my mind he'll be a good player this season. Tipping for young player of the year, right enough. So
just don't Ange Postecoglou then. Is he really coming at his own now as a manager? Yeah. Is that him? Is he
Celtic going? Fans, they're excited, and I can totally understand it. I think it's, you know, you can see what he's trying to do. I think that I love it. He's no nonsense. I know a lot of people have given him a bit of stick for the way he handles the media, but some of the shite he gets asked, he just gives it. That's fair enough. And the one thing I will say is, though, if Celtic end up going on a really bad run, it'll turn sour very quickly. But he's getting away with it just now because he's new. He's got a bit of charm about him, you know. And also he's telling the board, you know, what the script is. And Celtic fans are fully behind him. And that was the big thing he had to do, was get, because Eddie Howe had it before he was even in here. He had all the Celtic fans united. Postecoglou has now done that, to be fair to him. So the board have got to back him, because if they don't, the fans are going to be on their back.
He has a really exciting style of play as well. I think Celtic registered almost 30 shots at the weekend, and against teams like your Dundee, I can see them beating them teams like that 5-6-0. Do you know what I mean? Because of the style of play that they've got with the legs.
They'll
and
be
the
in a 4-4 with someone this season, though.
That's what I was going to say as well. Like, if Celtic do come up against your Rangers, your Hibs, Abderdeen, some of the stronger teams in the league, you would imagine some players like Martin Boyle, Ryan Kent, all these kind of guys will enjoy playing against that style. But I think Celtic will score goals too.
They don't have the defenders, though, so that's probably why. If they had the right defenders in place, then, you know, maybe they'd be
what
more
balanced.
What
kind of defender, then, are you saying?
Christopher Julian and Chris Iyer, I think, would suit Postecoglou down the ground. They're two players who can play with the ball at their feet. They're both pacey. You know, they would be perfect. I mean, Julian's still months away by the sounds of things, so they need to buy centre halves. I don't think they'll sign the players they need to in the rest of this window. They'll probably get two more in, but I think they're needing four or five, to be honest. I think that Celtic are going to improve a lot on last season. You're already seeing that's going to happen, but whether they're going to be quite strong enough to catch Rangers, it all just depends on how Rangers do. I mean, I'm sitting here assuming they're going to bounce back and assuming they'll get back to the best, but that's not guaranteed. Nothing's guaranteed. So they're going to have a bit. The thing is, Rangers will have a bit of pressure on them because of Celtic this season that they didn't have last year.
Yeah,
that's an interesting dynamic.
Aye, and there's a lot of strong teams in the league as well.
Yeah.
To go away from Scottish football a wee bit for a minute, we need to show homage to one of the greatest ever, if not the greatest, I know.
The greatest ever.
The greatest. The greatest technical footballer of all time, certainly up there with Diego Maradona, in my opinion. Messi has left.
Yeah, Maradona.
I don't know. I think it's up for debate. I really do. I think Maradona's up there with Messi, personally.
Yeah, that's the way to phrase it, not the other way around. Messi is the GOAT.
Let's talk about Lionel Messi a wee bit for just a wee second then. He's left Barcelona. He's wearing the PSG top. Thinks he's gone to there.
Mate, I hate PSG, but this is lovely.
Right. Lad, that's frightening, isn't it? Their front three, what it could be.
I know, man.
Right, if you could rewind the clocks to one Messi moment.
Oh.
Right? What's it going to be and why?
Oh, that's a good question.
So I can kickstart us because obviously I've had this question in the bank. So the moment that I would rewind it to, he's obviously had a lot, but one that really sticks out to me was the 23rd of April 2017, last minute winner in the Clasico to make it 3-2 at the Bernabeu. He's 500th Barca goal. He's 500th Barca goal, and he takes his toe path, he runs up to the crowd and puts the Messi up.
That was cool.
See, to be there in that moment, I think that'd have been sensational. I was in a fucking bar in Amsterdam at the point. Scranning a burger before jumping a train.
What was the burger
up
like?
The road? What?
What was on the burger?
It was a hash brown burger.
Oh.
I'm sure it was.
Naughty.
But no.
I've got a moment. It's,
that'd be me.
I can't remember. I don't know who they were playing.
I've got a few.
But they went 2-0 up against Barcelona, and the manager was standing there, first stern faced, and the Messi came on, and they won 3-2. Mm. And they asked the opposing manager after the game, like, "We seen you went 2-0 up. Why did you not celebrate when the second goal went in?" He went, "Oh, I seen Messi warming up."
Yeah, mental. Right, so first one, 2009 Champions League final, when he scores that header over Van der Sar, boot comes off, and he's cutting about. The second one, that goal against Real Madrid at the Bernabeu, Busquets just...
Oh, Busquets assist. That's my favourite assist ever.
That was at the Bernabeu.
Yeah,
and take your face for a shake.
He just takes off and skins loads, slots it in, he's just the goat. And then the one against Bayern Munich where he's boating on his arse. That's an absolute cracker. And finally, the free kick against Liverpool in the Champions League in 2000.
Against your team?
Yeah, it was just that's one of the best free kicks ever.
His goal, the one that he mirrors Maradona.
That was early on in his career.
Early on.
There's so many
also,
moments.
When he was a teenager, scored a hat-trick and a 3-each draw at the Bernabeu. that was class.
Also, just while we're doing Messi, what else? What was the other one I was going to say? Okay, the one against Bilbao in the I'm sure it was the Copa del Rey final.
Bilbao.
And he just also, do you remember that touch he has where he heads it up and he takes it in and flicks it through the boy's legs.
See when the ball comes in and he managed to. How did he do that?
It's just phenomenal.
That is not physically possible.
He's just the greatest. That video Barcelona put up, this like the 8-minute video about his time, is just phenomenal.
That was sad. I was one that wanted him to move on to Pastors New, but
what was the Premier League?
I was the exact same as I want to see him in a different environment, and then as soon as I seen that video of him greeting all that, I was like, oh mate.
It's a flashback. There's one that's a slow motion touch versus Arsenal, I think, and then it flashes back to him on a Nash pitch in Barcelona
We are the luckiest, because we are truly, we've grown up from right from when we started football was when they started playing.
Ronaldo. And I've never seen any of them live.
I've seen Ronaldo.
So I've not seen either. So my thing pre-COVID was I was definitely going to go into Barcelona and see Messi, and COVID knackered it. It's going
to
be PSG.
We will never be able to see Messi play for Barcelona, lads.
That's sad, isn't it?
That's quite sad.
I've seen Ronaldo.
He'll do a Legends game.
I went to Man City Real with my school. The worst atmosphere I've ever been in my life. I think Man City had to win to go through the group, and Real scored first. I think Benzema scored, and then Aguero got a penalty like the 60th minute and scores it, and they were like,
City.
Right, from one goat to another, Stephen Glass has led Aberdeen there at the weekend.
What's he doing?
To a 2-1 victory.
Nah, fair play.
What do you mean, like resting players?
Resting players that are in my fantasy team. And in your fantasy team.
Exactly. If we want to talk about that, fantasy football, I have fell away, boys.
How many points did you get the weekend?
Let's have 30 points. Absolutely pathetic for me. Adam Kennedy's fell down to 22nd in the leaderboard. I tell you something, seeing the top Scottish football
How
fantasy
does he
league,
do it? Because his predictions are always class as well.
Yeah, seeing the TSF Fantasy League, the standard is incredible, boys. So you need to be really at the races if you want to do anything. I get 30 points. Embarrassing for me. I had Ramsey as my vice-captain. Didn't start him. I had Lewis Ferguson in the midfield. Didn't start him. And I had Ramirez as my striker. Didn't fucking start him.
Well, I had Tavernier as my captain and Kent as my vice. So then you fucking
go. I had Tavernier as my captain. Fantasy football. I make a team. And then I just...
And you just never go back.
I'm saying I'm going to take it seriously this year. So I'm 292nd in the league.
Oh, God.
But my team's called Peter Grant Sexy Football. And it's not a thing anymore.
How many people are in it?
634.
Oh, really?
We'll just give a shout out to the ones that are up near the top just now. So,
yeah, let's do it.
Jamie Costello is in first with Hugh Keevan's FC. He got 104 points this weekend.
That's insane.
He's on 190. Second is Pookie Blinders, Jamie Spears, with 89 points this weekend. And third is Keir Miller, who I think's a Kelly fan. His team's just called I Miss Kabamba.
How many points did you get?
The weekend I got 30 odd points.
I got
30 40. Odd?
I got, what's that? Like 31 or something.
I got 31 on
that. I got 43. So thank God for Liam Boyce and Martin Boyle, is all I'm saying.
Yeah, I think I'm like 122nd in the leaderboard, so not too bad.
The most points I got was for Halliday.
I had him in
the 10 points.
But anyway, on to Aberdeen then. He did rest players, which makes this victory a wee bit more impressive.
More impressive because they were hopeless for large parts.
Yeah, they were indeed. They had Brown at the team, McCrory, Ferguson, Ramirez. Other kind of top boys didn't start the match, but it kind of shows you the strength and depth to a certain extent that we're still able to replace him and get the victory.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think a lot of Aberdeen fans said on social media and stuff that last year they would have drawn that game. A lot of them replied to that by saying last year we would have lost that game. I mean, fair play. I think Aberdeen are going to be decent this year. I still think that a lot of people are tapping them to do really, really well. I think they're probably still early on in Glass's kind of plan he's got for them. I think it'll take a year or two to really get to what he wants. In terms of squad, I mean, he's got some aging players. Like Brown's not going to kick around for much longer. Johnny Hayes is getting on a bit. Fair enough. What scenes at the end when they got that one? 95th minute.
It was, but what's the goalie doing?
What's the goalie, doing? What is he doing?
I know.
But the scenes are just phenomenal. Loved every minute of it.
Yeah, Livingston is like the easiest pitch to walk on if you want to walk on it. Yeah.
I was thinking that. Like, what's the stewards doing? But obviously, they're like, I don't get paid enough for this shit, man. On you go.
It's the smallest wee area, and then you're on the pitch.
Yeah.
I mean, see the absolute toffs and the snobs that were getting on at them. I mean, fuck off.
I know.
Just going phenomenal.
That's what football's all about.
Yeah. I mean, I just hope that fucking Sturgeon doesn't. No. Throw the toys at the pram, but
she won't. It's not one of the.
It's not one of the big two.
Exactly.
So she's not watching.
She's not. She doesn't give a fuck, mate.
She only gets her Scottish football coverage from Sky Sports, so she only knows about Celtic and Rangers. Yeah, fuck knows. But
so, David, what has Stephen Glass changed so far? Because this was a team that won the scoring goals last season. What is it he's done?
Well, I mean, good? Christian Ramirez has helped because he's a goal scorer. Quite, you know, frankly.
Two goals in the European game.
Yeah, looks a real really good well. Player. You know, it's kind of tough because see, at the start of last season, I thought Aberdeen were playing quite well. And I actually said, it was when we were doing them live shows at the start, I think I watched one of the Aberdeen games and I thought that they were playing better football than they normally did under McInnes, and that just died away.
The injuries and such.
They've got technical players, Aberdeen, and they're making the use out of them. I think Brown's made a big difference. I've not heard, a lot of Aberdeen fans are saying he's done well. They're not raving about him, but I think from what I've seen, he makes a big difference. Just even just the presence of having him in midfield, kind of conveys a bit of confidence.
He's doing what he was there for.
Yeah, and he's also got legs around him. I mean, Lewis Ferguson's normally beside him. Ojo, who's I think's done all right, and they're just playing a bit more, you know, free flowing football and having a bit of, because that's always been the criticism of Aberdeen, especially when they played the big two under McInnes, is they just went into their shell and they tried to play safe. Whereas he's clearly letting them, you know, have a go at teams, and I think when it's going to be really interesting when they play Celtic Rangers. That's the real thing.
When they play an old firm at Pathology, it'll be interesting.
Yeah,
100%. I think he's done a good job so far, and hopefully Aberdeen can actually progress in Europe as well. They're going
How
to
are
the
getting on with him.
They're going to the second league. So they're going to second game with a 3-2 victory, 3-2 away for him.
And Hibs drew one each.
What round is that?
So they're one off the playoff in the conference.
Something like that.
So I mean, the last Thursday was a great. We haven't done a show since then, but it was a great night because, you know, it was positive results for all four teams. Only one team let us down in Europe last week, but we'll leave that there.
Sorry, you've been carrying you.
Livingston are Bruce Anderson scored though. To be fair,
and he's a player that we thought would score goals.
Yeah, I said if Livy are going to stay up this year, he'll have to be key and score some goals. He obviously enjoyed that one against Aberdeen. I don't think he got a fair crack of the whip there. To be perfectly honest, with you, McInnes never really fancied him. But Livy could be in a little bit of trouble defensively. Yeah, Martindale was quite funny though at the weekend, talking about he was going to sign Messi and all that carry on.
Everybody just jumped on that line, didn't they? I seen Broomhill. They just posted a screenshot for the group chat, and it was somebody saying, "Mate, do you think you could Photoshop Lionel Messi's head on it?" And he's like, "No." They posted that instead, which I thought was quite good. On Livy then, to be a fly on the wall in that dressing room. What do you think David Martindale would have said? Because he loves it. Didn't he
would have done it in his high pitched screaming voice. I remember I'd covered the Celtic Livingston game, the one where Brown got sent off for the good beat, and Martindale was screaming at the jet the whole game.
Fucking
and
then
he was absolutely screaming at him first half, and he played in the left wing. Second half, when they switched teams, he obviously the jet was on the other side, so he switched his wing, so he was back beside him, so he just shouted at him for 90 minutes.
He scored that game or not, didn't he? The jet?
Yes, aye. I think so, yeah. But yeah, he wouldn't have been happy. But again, he's not quite. I think he made a new signing yesterday. I can't quite remember the boy's name. But Livy have done so well for so long there. I think that again, as it always is with them, their target is to stay up. I think if you offered him staying up by a point now, he would probably take it. But yeah, I think he would have been a not very happy man.
See, I'm in two minds with Martindale after that game. I feel like I think he's a good manager. I think he goes into that dressing room and I don't think so. I think he goes in and he knows what the boys are hurting and he knows what they're feeling. I think he's a bit more supportive in that situation rather than going after his nut, because losing a last minute goal hurts, man.
He'd be disappointed himself.
He will be raging.
He'll not need to tell the goalie he's made an asset.
But then to flip that, when you see Aberdeen coming to town, having played on Thursday, having rested a lot of the players at home,
true.
You should be thinking, right, that's 3 points for us here today.
Yeah.
Especially if they want to be where they have been, which is pushing top six, they should be looking at that kind of game. But again, as I said, it's always going to be about staying up for Livy. So
last thing I want to leave you on then, lads. Firstly, could Aberdeen break the top two?
No, if not,
that's a quick answer, right? That's a quick answer. When will we see another team challenge for this league? Because I heard that it was actually Hugh Keevans talking about it the other night in the radio, and he was saying Hibs, Hearts, Aberdeen, all these clubs, they say they're big clubs, but they need to start actually winning shit. Aye. You know, to prove it.
I don't think the league is in
surely
any,
not. But let's. I know that Rangers and Celtic's wage budgets are far superior
and
to theirs, right?
And their
but Edinburgh's still a big
tap two.
It's a big city. Aberdeen's a big city. You know, they're big clubs.
Yeah, and they've all got busloads going to Celtic and Rangers every week.
What's that?
They've all got buses going to Glasgow. Or
well,
Celtic
that's
Rangers
up to them then, maybe to try and change that culture. And then try.
I mean,
look at Sir Alex Ferguson, what he done in the 80s. Don't tell me it's not possible.
It was a lot even.
Do you know what I mean? Even look at what Jock Stein done for your club.
It was a much even playing field back then.
See the way football's gone, I'm not going to lie. I don't think I'll ever see a team win other than Rangers and Celtic.
No, definitely
in
not.
My lifetime.
We talk about it all the time.
It would be interesting. It would be interesting. I just don't see it happening.
We've got a TV deal with Sky Sports, and their entire like 95% of the coverage is about Celtic and Rangers. And then, I mean, that's not going to change. The money is where Celtic and Rangers are. It's too far gone. Back in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, it was a much more even playing field.
Money's changing.
And to criticise these teams
but
for not.
We've not got any fucking money, really.
We've got more than
Scottish League. I know we have, but.
I'd imagine
that some of the top clubs in Europe have got way more money. Bear money than in opposed to like an Aberdeen, we've maybe get less money in
the gap.
Gap between like, you know, Liverpool, I mean, and Arsenal is nowhere near as big as the gap between Rangers and Aberdeen financially. And look at how fucking far apart they are. So, you know, one final thing on this before I come to you. Aberdeen, Hibs and Hearts over the last, maybe not Aberdeen, but Hibs and Hearts, especially over the last 10 years where they've been in the Championship and they've been struggling. That's where you criticise them, because they should be all up there, third, fourth, fifth. That should be the, you know, the way things go. If we think Celtic and Rangers should be the top two, Aberdeen, Hibs and Hearts should be third, fourth, fifth. They haven't done that well enough over the last 10 years. That's what I think you can criticise them for.
See, if you look at like money again, like the Rangers waiting list for season tickets is bigger than Aberdeen's capacity. Like this, the levels of size of club is just massive. Now, Aberdeen's a big club, but when you look at the diff, like Celtic as well, have a waiting list probably bigger than Aberdeen's capacity. Just the size.
Not so sure.
What about then? Atletico Madrid, the size of that club, as opposed to Real Madrid and Barcelona? But they've still won a couple of titles in the last 10 years. Champions League finals, not arrested yet.
Yeah, again, but again, that's what I said about Liverpool Arsenal. The same thing. The gap between, well, Real Madrid and Barcelona are skint. So
you can't use that excuse. Come on,
I feel like
they'll find a million a week.
The attraction as well. Like, it'll be a lot easier to attract a big name to go and play Madrid instead of Barcelona.
I know,
than playing Aberdeen.
But Rangers and Celtic can't attract a player that Real Madrid and Barcelona.
Yeah, you're not seriously telling me that the gap between Real Madrid and Atletico Madrid is like smaller than is bigger than Aberdeen, Rangers and Celtic?
No, it isn't, to be fair, but I'm just using it as a...
It's the only one
I can really think of as an example.
We're unique in this country, and everything is... In the media, everything is geared around two teams.
The only thing I can think of to compare like an Aberdeen or something in the league is Leicester winning the Prem.
Yeah.
Do you think it's that far away?
A fluke.
I mean, if Aberdeen were...
I don't think Leicester winning the Premier League was a fluke.
I think that, like, you've got Hibs and Aberdeen...
The top six were shite that year.
I thought they were sensational, though. I thought they had the best players.
How many points did they win? They won over, like, 70 points.
They had a good season, but in terms of, like, the competition that year, it wasn't up to them.
In most other seasons, their points total would have had them fourth or third.
So if Rangers and Celtic keep dropping points this season, then what's
Rangers,
to say?
If Rangers and Celtic tank one year...
And but they're going to have to really tie.
And a Hibs or an Aberdeen absolutely bomb it.
You
also look at Rangers, right? See, in recent years, we brought in a guy like Ryan Jack, now one of the best body centre midfielders in the country, come for Aberdeen.
Yeah.
Scott Wright. Rangers have changed his full approach, you know, put a wee bit of weight on him. Now he looks sensational. So there's top players in this league. Mm-hmm. And through the years, Rangers and Celtic have fished in the markets. I mean, we're talking about Nisbet coming in and changing things for Celtic, maybe no new, but surely there's still talent there, and then with some guidance and a top manager, then they could challenge.
Why do they get better at Celtic and Rangers?
Better coaches, better facilities,
better sports scientists, better everything.
Yep.
You know, and it's not like they're taking the entire Aberdeen team, they're taking one out of that team and making him a Rangers player.
You're putting a player like Ryan Jack into a team surrounded by talent, he's going to show his own talent.
In our lifetime, the closest it could have been was if Hibs had kept their team in about 06, if they'd have kept that team together, you know, Whitaker, O'Connor, Riordan, Brown, Thompson, if they'd have kept that team together another year, they maybe could have gone.
The best chances when we were done and Celtic won they were one in the league, but they won convincingly, doing amazing, like at the first couple of seasons.
No,
that would have been the moment to, like, if it's going to happen, it's going to happen. But I mean, it's not like
Aberdeen can just go and spend 5-6-7 million
pound a window. Exactly. Celtic
still coasted it. There's not enough profit in Scottish football for a team to have a short-term approach.
Yeah. No, I know. I'm probably in your guys' like side here, but I just kind of wanted to
be devil's advocate. I don't know.
Get your opinion on it a wee bit. It probably would make for a better league if there was three or four teams challenging for the title. But see, even if you're looking further afield, you look at Serie A, and Milan won it last season, but you know, Juve dominated that for years. There is teams in other leagues, Bayerns and all that, they in PSG, they dominate. There is the odd occasion that another team wins.
If Rangers don't win the league, there's 10 other teams I'd rather win than Celtic, so I'm going to be opposed to it. Get them firmly.
Don't count out St Johnston, mate.
Right. By the way, we need to get through
the rest of these fucking games. So
we're going to fly through them quickly, mate.
You need to check TSM messages. I think you've been messaged a wee quiz.
Aye, good. Right. St Mirren 1, Hearts 2. Andy Halliday popped up with a great goal. And then Boyce in the second half, another good goal.
Goal and assist for Boyce.
Yep.
Yep.
How good will he be this season, David?
Massive. Because, I mean, when he came in, when they got relegated, he scored a couple of goals, but he wasn't quite there. Last year in the Championship, he did it right. This year, he will really do well because he's a top goal scorer. He was top scorer in the league at one point not that long ago. And again, I mentioned earlier about Hart signing Shankland. I mean, you've got Liam Boyce, who I think could be just as good, if not a little bit better, to be honest. So, yeah, he'll do really well. Halliday seems to have come into his own at Hearts now. And also, I mean, defensively was the thing that cost them when they got relegated, but now...
Solid at defence.
Yeah, I mean, Halkett and Suter now fit again. I tell you what, and here's another interesting thing. He obviously played against Celtic in a back three. Scotland player back three. John Suter's still going to be in the fringes. He's still going to be in Steve Clark's mind about coming back into that squad. We are struggling for centre-half, so that's a good option to have.
Yeah,
good result for Hearts, especially because there's a lot of needle in that fixture now after St Mirren relegated them. Well, kind of didn't. Last time they were in there.
What do you think Hearts are finishing?
What did I say last week? Probably stick that. I think I said 8th.
I said 7th, but they're doing well so far.
Yeah.
I think 6th.
So this is the thing, and it's something that it's crazy because Celtic and Rangers both lost already. We've made predictions, and already a lot of people are revising their predictions we made 2 weeks ago, but it's a 38-game season. Teams are going to get beat at points. But yeah, great result for Hearts.
We need to also talk about, I don't know if you've seen the red card on Dennis. I seen the last half an hour, so I'll talk to you, right? So,
Dennis the Menace.
Goodwin throws Big Shaughnessy up front, and he scores a bullet header, right? Makes it 2-1 with a few minutes to go. Kickoff Adams, the ball gets passed back to Herring in the midfield. He lets it run through. Dennis is just on, right? And he runs past Herring, fuck you with the elbow. Straight red card, off the pitch. That's it. That's Goodwin must have been raging, man.
And he is a man that can lose his temper.
Oh, my God. It was a moment of madness.
What was the thing I was going to say? I can't even remember. I've lost it now. Whatever the fuck I was going to say. Oh, I was not to say Mirren fan at work. And he's not happy with Jim Goodwin.
Oh, really?
Not happy at all. I said, well, he's done wonders for you. What are you on about? And he said, well, you know, we want to be pushing top six and we're getting beat off a newly promoted team at home. And I think...
It is early doors, though, isn't
it? It is early doors. And also, it's a bit of an anomaly with Hearts.
It's also Hearts,
But I kind of take the point, though, because I think I predicted St Mirren to finish higher than Hearts this season.
I think I did. I did below.
Yeah, well, anyway, I mean, at home, I can understand the frustration a little bit. Could St Mirren get beaten the opening weekend as well? I can't really remember now.
Yeah, they drew.
No, they drew up at Dens, didn't they?
At
Dens. Yeah.
But
so,
do you know what I mean?
So that was the thing. Two newly promoted teams and they take 1 point.
You're expecting to win that.
Yeah. So that's, I can understand that. But again, it's very, very early on.
Makes sense. Hibs 3, Ross County 0. Martin Boyle continues his rich vein of form.
They just went 3-0 up and just went, that'll do.
Aye.
Hibs,
they're looking good.
They are looking very good. And last season, you know, they did all right. And they obviously finished third, which is great. But I didn't feel last season they were as good as they could have been, and now we're starting to see a little bit of form. Nesbitt's back in form, looks like he's staying. Boyle looks phenomenal. Midfield, they look great. Defensively, look all right. Doig back in the team with an assist at the weekend.
And his first game in front of fans.
Yeah. So
interesting fact for these lads.
Lots to be happy about for the Hibs, and I think they've got more of a chance of challenging for second. I don't think either will, but I think if one, I think it'll be Hibs.
Yeah, on Ross County then, Jack. Not looking good for them, is it?
I predicted them to go down, to be fair. Like, I've seen a few people saying Dundee United are going to go down.
I had
Dundee United 11th.
I don't see them going down anyway, but Ross County are my bottom team for me. How quick did Hibs go 3-0 up?
It was 27, 30 minutes or something.
Is that actual?
I can't remember.
It was in the first half and then they kind of just chilled.
That's smart game.
Because they've got a European game as well on Thursday.
That's smart. Like,
They've got a tough European game as well in Croatia.
Yes.
They go over there 1-0.
The one thing I will say though is they should have won that first game. They were pretty comfortable. They dominated the ball. They had lots of chances.
I wonder what that feels like.
They couldn't get it done. And I think they will get it done this week.
Do you think so?
Yeah, definitely.
Oh.
Here's another thing about Hibs, right?
Hopefully.
I've seen them a lot just now. They've been starting quite a lot recently with Nisbet up top on his own, and they could bring Christian Doig on after an hour. There's not many teams in the whole league that have got that luxury to bring on a goal scorer of that quality with long to go. You know, should, when you think about it. I mean, Celtic don't have that just now.
No. I know that it's always tough, right, for other teams out with the Old Firm, but to throw it in again, some Hibs fans were disappointed with Jack Ross last season and the Cups and such, yes, getting to the semis. Mm-hmm. Did they get to the final as well?
No, semis twice.
Semis, yeah, and getting put out. Should they be challenging for a cup this season with the squad that they've got?
100%.
And can they win one?
Yes, and here's another thing. Because Celtic and Rangers, I think, are going to be more challenging. Celtic are going to challenge Rangers more this year. You know, Rangers are going to be in a tougher fight in the league. And also, if Rangers get the Champions League, they're going to they'll be resting players in cup games. You can just see it now. As much as Gerrard will be desperate to win a cup, every chance for Hibs. Because Hibs can be in a position where they can rest players in the league for the cup. Because, mm-hmm, I mean, winning a cup is probably... I mean, we know how massive winning the cup is to Hibs. Fucking took them long enough.
If Rangers get Champions League, you're playing a group game on a Tuesday and you might be playing a cup game on a Saturday, you're definitely resting
Or a Friday on the telly.
You're definitely resting players for the Champions League.
Right, last game of the weekend then, the top flight. St Johnston 1, Motherwell 1.
Tony Watt scored, and he was the one player I want to talk about from this game. He's really seemed to find a bit of...
Came off the bench as well. It looked like a statement when he scored that goal.
He looks... Have you noticed he's got the low socks just now?
Yeah.
He's rocking the low socks. He is looking fucking phenomenal.
See, ever since he went to Bulgaria, see if he's came back. He's been looking after himself, man. You all right, mate?
He is phenomenal, by the way.
He's looking phenomenal. Just want to get him on the show.
Right, you regain your composure now, reset the camera. Right, we've calmed David Dunn. What were you saying?
Tony Watt got me all hot and flustered there. And he's because I've always thought he took up.
I said, Jack's away. That's him, he's done.
Pushed. He's always got a lot of stick about jumping about clubs, but he seems settled there. He scored a good goal. And yeah, point for St Johnson at the weekend. Probably not the worst thing after the test they had on Thursday night.
Yes. Xander Clark made a lot of saves in this game as well.
That was the other thing I was going to say. Steve Clark was there at the weekend.
At Dundee United game as well?
No.
He was at Rangers.
Oh, well, he was at Motherwell St Johnstone on Sunday. Someone said, I wonder if he's going to realise now that St Johnstone have got some good players.
Do you know what's madness? So I'm searching, right? I was desperately trying to try and get somebody St Johnstone related on the podcast today to phone them. Couldn't find anybody. So I searched it on YouTube, St Johnstone podcast, and up pops a podcast with Ali McCann. He's Scottish.
Is he?
He's fucking Scottish. His mum is like English, his dad's from Northern Ireland, but he is as Scottish as they come.
Well, his brother Lewis plays for Dunfermline and he also plays for Northern Ireland.
Madness.
So, does he have a funny voice like James McCarthy?
No.
Played a couple of games.
What's that all about, man? Come on. He's like a mix of Brendan Rodgers and Charlie Adam, I think.
Mate, it's a better impression than that mad guy that does the impression.
It's a better Brendan Rodgers impression than Brendan Rodgers himself could do,
played
I think.
Played a couple of games.
Yeah. Where were we there? Aye, so Steve Clark was at that game. And also, I want to come on to some Scotland stuff because there's a couple of things I want to bring on. That rounds up the Premiership games before we come on to the other leagues. So, obviously, David Marshall now looks like he's going to be third choice at Derby this season, which I would imagine would very much limit his Scotland career going forward, which, you know, upsets me a little bit because I love Marshy. But
he needs to leave.
We also need to find a goalie because our goalies are all pretty old. And Xander Clark...
29 years old, mate.
Seems like the kind of guy that is due a cap. You look around the goalies just now and you think, right, who's really going to be the next ones coming through? Xander Clark is probably the standout.
Kelly at Motherwell. He's about 26, so he's younger.
Yeah, and you've got McCrory below that. But we've gone from being so spoiled, again, and it's what we've mentioned that about Ronaldo and Messi, but in our generation of Scottish goalkeepers, we've had McGregor, Marshall, Gordon all at the same time. We've never had an issue.
You just compare Messi and Ronaldo.
We've never had an issue with goalies, and now we've got a massive issue coming up.
Yeah, although I'm going to put Marshall in the same league as A2, but anyway, that's another debate, isn't it? You love Marshall, don't you? You're still standing.
It's just all these people that didn't watch Scotland before they were good, and Marshall was great for so long.
When was Scotland?
I watched Scotland.
Are we good tonight?
Well, you should know that Marshall's been solid in goal for Scotland for years.
He's been alright.
He's been very good for years.
It's mad with the freedom, as they've all got similar caps. Craig Gordon, Alan McGregor, and
they've all had like periods of being the one, haven't they?
Gordon's got a few, hasn't he?
Yeah, I mean, Gordon's mainly came in like 2007, 2008, 2009, that kind of thing before he got really badly injured. Other Scotland stuff we can come on to. Andy Robertson did his ligament damage at the weekend, was spotted in a moon boot and crutches. Very much precautionary though. Sounds like he should be fit for the international break though, which is a positive. Although there are some fannies on Twitter that think that Robertson being fit is a negative. fucking deluded. So yeah,
it's ironic that our two best players are left backs.
It is also because I saw obviously people going, oh, I can't wait to see Tierney play left back because Robertson's injured. Is it just me that remembers the fact that Robertson was probably our best player at the Euros? Was it just me that watched that? No,
No, it wasn't.
He was phenomenal at the Euros.
But it is exciting now that Tierney's going to be playing left back. He won't, because I just said
he'll back for the national break, but you weren't listening, so.
I thought he did. I was trying to get the Twitter questions up, and the internet isn't working.
You need to get it on your phone, no?
I'll get it on my phone.
It's just ligament damage. When you go on your phone, two or three games. So he should be back in time.
Oh, Jesus, I thought it was ligament damage.
Nah, it was. But it's just like soft. Like, it's nothing meant. Two or three games.
Oh, so it's just like maybe a wee strain. It's not pulling it, man.
But did you see it, though?
No,
like his ankle fucking went like that. It was horrible. So that was a worry, but he's fine. So yeah, I'm looking forward to the internationals. Actually, it's going to be, because it's been a bit frantic the start to this club season, hasn't it? It's been it's mental. There's loads of games. I think the international break will come at a nice time for everyone. Actually,
when does the Prem start?
This weekend.
Don't care.
This weekend.
Don't care.
Don't give a shit though.
Nah, I don't mind the Prem.
Can I get
up? I always want to do a Scottish. I always want to do a Scottish boys down south show and just do like a quick 20-minute show every week talking about the guys down south. The only team I'm watching the Prem this season is Norwich.
Oh, aye, because Wee Billy.
I mean, they already love him.
The King.
They already love him. So him and McKennie McLean doing bits down there this season is going to be very, very good to see.
Is that done with the Scotland top?
Yeah.
Can we go back a wee minute just to St Johnstone and give them some credit for the heroics midweek versus Galatasaray? They've obviously got a huge game coming up on Thursday, and we wish them all the best.
My brother put £10 on St Johnstone and then cashed out when he scored.
£90?
Aye, roughly.
I was going to do the same, but
were they fucking 8-1? Were they
10-1?
10-1.
Hanky cashed out like £60, but
it's decent.
Fair enough,
not bad.
They were fantastic. Ali McCann was unbelievable. Fair play, and they probably are going to be a bit annoyed that they didn't win it because they conceded a bit of a sloppy goal. They just overexposed on that side and got done.
Yeah.
Before you want to come to the question, shall I just fire in a couple of wee stories from?
Oh yes, we've got a newbie segment. It's called Davey's Shit Sandwich. No, I don't know.
This is just basically because no one else can be asked talking about lower leagues.
No, I'll talk about the lower leagues, but the issue is we're on 56 minutes.
Well, that's because you spent fucking 15 minutes talking about could Hibs and Abderdeen win the league.
Exactly. People wanted to watch that. I think they did. I think they did.
No, they want to know about Peterhead and how they're doing this season.
Well, to be fair, they get pumped to Falkirk at the weekend. Nah. Don't worry, I know what I'm talking about. Well, anyway.
How did yous go on?
I prefer not to speak.
I know. I was actually.
If I speak, I'm in big trouble.
I was actually going to start the podcast.
Well, if we're going to call this segment the shit sandwich, I might as well fucking start at East End Park. Because the whole afternoon was a shit sandwich.
When you get like a wee harp sound. Like.
So,
the idea of a shit sandwich is though, David. Good, shit, good.
This was just shit, shit, shit.
Was it like a shit sandwich on some wholemeal pish?
Yeah, it was like seeded bread shit sandwich. I quite like seeded bread, actually. Nah. Seed toasted, especially.
I know, embarrassing.
Right, so I've gone in 2 weeks' time from being convinced we're going to win the league this year to we might get fucking relegated. Nah, obviously not. I mean, it's two games in, but Dunfermline were hopeless against Morton for 45 last week, and they were dreadful against Partick Thistle for 85 this week. We had 5 good minutes to start the second half, but we were already 2-0 down and the third went in. Just fucking awful. I said it on Twitter, I don't even think Thistle were that great. And I think they'll probably think they've got more to come. Just defensively, fucking atrocious. Like, Kyle Turner's playing with Thistle now, we had him last season.
Yeah, I remember
him. He comes over to take a corner, boys to the right of me start booing him and giving him shit as he comes over to take the corner. I'm like, why have you done that? Floats the ball in, 1-0. Next corner comes in, Turner floats it in, 2-0. Just shut the fuck up and leave him alone, alright? So we're 2-0 down, he's bossing it in midfield. We can't string a pass together. Graham Dorans looks like he's still fucking playing in Australia. He's just upside down, he's miles off it.
I heard that.
Just awful, absolutely awful. We had 5 good minutes to start the second half, apart from that dreadful. And now we play Rangers on Friday night, who are probably going to be pissed off and looking for a reaction.
Hopefully,
because he'll still be pissed off from last week, and we'll get done 10-0, and it'll just be awful. But I'm still paying £20 and going. Because I'm an addict and
see you there.
We're buying £20 and going as well, aren't we, Jack?
Exactly.
Unless somebody wants a ticket after.
Do you want to go?
So that's the start of the shit sandwich.
I'll scan the ticket.
Couple of good things for the lower leagues this week. If you get a chance, go and watch Jamie Bardonas' assist for Kelty Hearts.
Oh, talk to me to Joe Cardle.
Yeah. Flings it in, just floats it over into Joe's chest. Vintage Cardle takes it, lovely finish. What a pass, though. I mean, wait a pass, phenomenal.
How Jamie Bardonas is doing in the bottom league, I don't know.
That Kelty team is phenomenal. Bardonas, Higginbotham, Cardle, Austin, Tam O'Ware at the back, you've got man of the match. Kelty doing really well. They're probably going to start taking Dunfermline fans away. He'll go and watch Kelty now because. Yeah, they've got
Stirling were my pick for the league as well, so I was expecting that to be a tough game for them.
It was a tough game for them.
But still, 3-1's a great result.
Yeah, great result. I mean, I've tipped Kelty just because how good their squad is, but fair play to them. Falkirk won. They look like they've hit a bit of form there. Sheeran looks like he's going to do a good job there, so they might come up this year.
Any other positives then?
What else happened down there? The
top three leagues.
The top three, aye, the big three. Aye, yeah. What else happened? Can't think. Oh, Hamilton got beat again. You see that?
Yeah.
I say again, they drew last week. Remarkably,
four each.
But cracking game, by the way.
Morton won at New Douglas, which is. Phenomenal result for them.
So there's fuck all to talk about in the low leagues. That's why I'm
well, I've just done no research.
So we started at 56, we're at 59 now. Near
so normally what happens is I get read a list of fixtures and stuff just pops into my head that I've seen. I never come prepared for this. Someone will say, so it was Annan 3, and I'll be like, did you fucking see what happened in the Annan game? I've got nothing to prompt.
Well, did you see what happened in the Albion game the other week?
Yes. I was missing, I would have brought that up, but he's fucking forgot.
I did forget.
Yeah.
I should have been the only one that knew anyway, mate.
It's annoying because if we'd have planned that, we probably could have got someone from Edinburgh City on the line to talk about that.
Yeah.
Gary Naismith fuming. So, yeah.
We could have. So
Is that in the lower leagues this week?
No.
At least I knew what you were talking about, mate.
I think what else happened.
Jamie Bell Jonas was good.
It was a great pass. Go and watch that because you will not regret it. What a pass.
Oh, League One. A boy, Sam.
Oh, that was that is the definition of a shit sandwich.
Yeah.
Sam has been done dirty. So,
talk us about the game.
He's on a booking against Dumbarton.
2-0 up.
2-0 up, flying. What a team they've got, by the way. See, they're starting 11. Frightening. They're going to do really well. Anyway, so 2-0 up. Sam's on a booking. Pretty poor from him getting booked in the first place. Nah, joking. And then he goes and gets done a second yellow, and it is a shocker. The Barton boys, they're pretty much side by side. Sam's rushing at the ball. The Dumbarton boy steps across him. Sam ends up going into the back of him. They both go down. Looked like Sam was fouled to me.
Yep,
and the referee sends him off second yellow. Shocker. And it was the same referee that didn't book Brian Graham when he fractured his eye socket.
I know. So that referee's obviously
doesn't like Sam.
A vendetta against us. Doesn't like Sam.
Doesn't like TikTok.
Which means he's got a problem with us.
So we will find out that referee and we'll be coming for him every week now.
Aye, absolutely. And then... ends up 2-each.
Yeah, ends up 2-each. It's also his former club as well.
Exactly.
What minute was it in?
It was in the 57th minute. He gets a red card and then two goals followed. Oh, made it 2-all, which would have been a great result for Airdrie because they really kicked on for that because they've had a difficult start in the cup as well. Other than obviously
Their team looks really, really good.
Yeah.
And I think they're going to do well this year.
Yeah, absolutely.
Hopefully. So justice for Sam.
Justice for Sam.
We always do a thing. We've started a thing recently where if you get to the end of the show, put something in the comments. That's what we want in the comments this week. # justice for
Sam.
Justice
for Sam.
Yeah.
Oh, we're going to get a few of them, hopefully.
Yeah.
We're going to get a few of them.
It's now 11 o'clock, so Sam's already been up for about 7 hours this morning.
He's already read a book.
Yeah.
Oh, I mean, a full book.
Ran a 5K.
Ran a 5K in 20 minutes. No, 12 minutes probably. You know what I mean?
Yeah, phenomenal.
Done about 3 coaching sessions. The boy's just on top of it.
Doesn't stop.
Great lad, we need to get him back on soon. Right, Twitter questions.
Hit me, bitch.
Beans asks...
Oh, I've seen this one already, I like it.
If you could go to Ibiza with one footballer, one politician and one musician, who would you pick and why? So a footballer, a politician and a musician.
So the footballer I'm taking to Ibiza is...
I'm taking Jason Cummins.
Yeah.
Definitely. I was thinking Jason Cummins.
So I was going to say, you know who I was going to say? I was going to say Cal Naismith because I've seen him once at open goal and I can just tell he's going to be an absolute legend. He was one that, but Cummins, yeah, you have to take Cumdog, don't you?
Although Rooney for St. Johnson would be decent enough.
He would. I don't know. What
Alfredo Morelos.
Oh.
He'll not fucking come back if you do that. Like
exactly.
So, and then, right, so one musician I'm taking, Jason Cummins, Paolo Nutini, and politician, this is where it gets really fucking interesting. So there's numerous ways you can go with this because you're obviously just looking to have a really good time and just party. So, fuck knows, man. Let me think about this really quickly.
Musician, I'm taking... Who am I taking? Throw us a musician out there, Jack.
Liam Gallagher.
Liam Gallagher was one that sprung to mind.
That would knob, though.
Aye.
I'm a big fan of...
What politician am I taking to Ibiza? This is a really difficult question.
I love Postie. I'd take Post Malone.
Postie? He'd be decent, to be fair.
Love Postie.
I'll take 50 Cent, because I think he'd be a laugh. In the club.
The politician I'm going to take...
Love it down the dog, down the tap.
fuck it.
We take Boris Johnson.
Aye, big Bojo, man. Get Bojo.
You need to come back closer to the mic so they can
And
get Bojo and
follow it. No, see, imagine, you know that Jacob Rees-Mogg guy, the guy with the glasses, poor Toff.
Nah.
You've not seen him. You'll know him if you see him. He's a guy that fell asleep on the in the parliament, and they asked him on a TV show when the last time he done cocaine was, because he'd admitted to doing it, so he'll be a party animal. But he's a fucking Tory wank, so I'm not taking him. I know we don't do politics on this show, but fuck me, I founded it, so I don't give a shit. Fuck it, I don't know. I'm not taking a politician. They're all arseholes.
Most of them are, to be fair, aren't they?
There's not really that many characters.
Would you take Nicola Sturgeon? Do you know
love
her?
No, I don't love Nicola Sturgeon, not at all.
I thought you were in love with her.
I've done a video on this channel slagging her.
Have you?
Yeah.
Oh, aye. I thought you fancied her.
Just a bit of kit, to be fair. No, obviously not.
Comes up here with a toffee apple, man.
There's not really many characters, especially in Scottish politics, is there really? No.
Who's the Scottish
Mary Black. Mary Black.
She goes off on that, doing it Westminster all the time.
She'd be a party animal, probably.
Aye.
Pure scheme bug.
Pure up for it.
This is fucking
No politicians coming then?
I'm taking Jeremy Corbyn with me, why not?
Tommy Sheridan.
The Corbyn.
Oh, Tommy Sheridan, that's right, fucking right.
Tell us a line, what a tan
he'd end up with.
Aye.
A
disaster.
Fake it's tan before he went out there. Absolutely, you could get him pissed and he would just start slagging everyone.
Yeah.
That would be hilarious. I remember one time walking out from college, walking into town to get something to eat, and he was in George Square with a megaphone.
I walked,
just ranting.
See, the day after the 4-1. Old fun one. I seen him walking across a bridge and he looked clinically depressed. And I was like,
let's hope no.
No, of course it isn't. But he looked rough. And I was like,
it's been a rough year.
Jason Cummings, Paolo Tini, Tommy Sheridan, and me going to Ibiza. What a laugh.
Sounds like a good night.
It's just going to be a whole night of me just trying to wind up Sheridan and hope that he just bites. Goes for somebody. And it won't take much, to be fair.
Aye.
I'll just tell him that Neil Lennon's a shite manager and he'll be off.
He's a Celtic man.
Stand behind our manager.
Aaron Smith asks,
what a jailbait segment at the podcast that was.
Christy, Kyogo and Abada or Kent, Morelos or Hadji?
I saw this question, so I'm going to go with Kent, Kyogo and Morelos.
Oh, is no, it? I think he's meaning you can only choose.
Is it mix and match or is it one of them?
You can only choose one. It's only one answer.
Yeah,
though.
It's obviously only one answer.
Aye, of course it is.
I mean, the Celtic fans are frightening, so it's got to be that. It's obviously the... Ask us again in 6 months.
Yeah.
That's a good point. Maybe we can get
a more...
Abada looks good.
Educated. Abada looks all right.
Yeah, he looks really good.
Christy, I'm a big fan of Ryan Christy. But again, you can't just say because one had a shite weekend and the other had a good weekend.
Aye, the timing of the question is
it's
key.
Just that question is just down to one weekend. He's done football. His
ill. Joshua Singh asks, what do you make of Chris Butt for Kilmarnock potential championship player of the year? He's a guy that we talk about every year, Benjamin Button, never ages.
He's still got it. His delivery is just phenomenal.
Yep.
He would be a good postie, actually, after he's done.
Always delivering.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, maybe if Kelly go up, he'll be a big part. But I would imagine, I don't really want to talk about the championship just now because I'm just too upset.
This is another belter for you, David, to showcase your lower leagues knowledge, if you're going to go with a lower leagues team. Luke Keyhole, sorry mate, I butchered your second name.
Keyhole surgery.
Check your appendix. Any surprise teams to go far in either the Scottish Cup or the League Cup?
Dunfermline, obviously.
Partick Thistle?
Dunfermline.
They've started well, Partick.
They're not out of the League Cup. Pretty sure they are.
Aye, but there's
also them out of the cup.
If you would have listened, the Scottish Cup was also in there. Prick.
Okay. Right, okay. Dunfermline are going to go through on Friday, so... Can you imagine if somewhere we beat you lot on Friday? Just imagine.
No.
Next week's show would be phenomenal, wouldn't
if
it?
If you beat us, I'll do this in my boxers.
Oh, Div, you've got to do something if we beat you on Friday for next week's show.
No, Jack can do it.
He might not be available, though.
What?
He might not be available for next week's show. Come on, if Dunfermline beat Rangers on Friday, you've got to do a forfeit next week. Come on.
Hey, go give me a forfeit.
You've got to, like, wear something there.
You got a Dunfermline top?
Oh, yeah, you got to wear a Dunfermline top next week if we beat you. Yeah? If we beat you, you've got to wear a Dunfermline top on the show next week.
Right, okay.
That's not that bad, actually.
I'm desperately trying to fucking get these messages from Matthew Duff.
It's on the podcast account.
It's not on the podcast account, is it?
Let me see then.
Did you see it?
No, I just saw that he'd messaged.
All right, I've got one. Right. On to the quiz then, lads.
Yeah, so he's wearing a Dunfermline top when we beat them next week.
What's the button?
Top left. That sort of stuff on in Mango last night.
Why is it so loud? How did I turn that down?
I don't know, mate. It doesn't really matter.
Sorry to all headphone users.
Aye, us.
I don't aye, us as well. I don't like the fucking flippery coin thing, right? So I need you to play Rock, Paper, Scissors, boys, to see who...
Jack can just decide if he wants to go first or second.
Oh, really? Yeah. All right, aye.
Second.
Do I go second? Aye, okay.
That's good, because I wanted to go first.
Question one. Which SPFL defender has more caps for Sweden, Carl Starfelt or Philip Hylander?
Oh yeah, fuck, that's a great question, isn't it?
I know what I had to say.
Carl Starfelt.
Oof, you've had a fucking nightmare there, mate. Obviously, Hallander.
Is it?
Hallander, 16-3.
Oh, wow. I only said that because I don't know. I've not really paid attention to Starfelt's career.
No, he's not really had a lot of hangies. I think he's younger than Hallander, though, so. Right, Jack.
Has he lost a league game yet, just out of interest?
Fuck off. In fact, RIP to has Hallander lost a league game, man. Jeez,
no,
it was
did
a
he tweet
day.
Yes, did he?
He just typed yes the other day.
That was quite funny.
And that was it. Now he's away.
That's him going.
He's away. Fucking great part of him, but for the last 500
he took it on the chin.
Right, second question. Well, first question for you, Jack. Which Scotland international scored an own goal during the weekend's fixtures? Didn't even mention them.
Like Scottish fixtures?
Yeah. Scottish international in the Scottish League. Who scored an own goal? He said a fucking horror start of the season, the man.
Oh, shit.
Didn't have a good summer either.
I didn't know.
Didn't have a good summer.
Oh.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
I'm not going to get it.
Right, he gave a penalty away in the opening day as well. So, what's your answer?
Was it O'Donnell?
Yes, it was.
Yeah.
An own
so
goal.
We'll answer each other's questions.
Yeah, pretty much. I know, we chose this.
I mean, we spoke about the game, so you probably should have knew what had happened. Do you know what I mean?
I know. Well, I did. I got it right, Div.
So you did. Right, let's see if you get this right. Partick Thistle are currently spearheading, I know it's a sensitive subject, the Scottish Championship after back-to-back wins.
Yeah.
But what is the name of the world-famous mascot?
Kingsley.
Correct.
That'll do, to be fair.
Oh my god, I'm keeping my finger at the button, boys. Right. Kyogo managed a hat-trick in his home debut, but who was the last player to score a hat-trick in the SPFL? Was it?
Oh, what a question that is.
Right, on you go.
There's options here. I'm not getting
options.
I'm not
getting options.
Last player scored a hat trick in the SPFL. In the Premiership, or
I don't know
Nisbet.
Well, you will.
I'll go ahead and tell you that it's in the Premiership. Ah, okay, just to narrow it down. Is that your final answer?
I guess Nisbet.
What are you saying?
I'm trying to think. It was a Rangers player, but I can't remember a Rangers player scoring many hat tricks last season. I don't know. No idea.
It was Kyle Lafferty versus Dundee
United. Oh, of course it was.
On the 21st of April.
Because he was an absolute machine, wasn't he?
He was flying the boy. Right, back to friend of the show. Brilliant, we've spoken. Oh no, this could be a nightmare here if we've already spoken about it. Right, David. Friend of the show, Sam Wardrop, was controversially sent off against Dumbarton at the weekend, but what was the final score?
2-2.
Unlucky, Jack.
Is there a tiebreaker question he's given us?
Yes.
Right, do you want to just... Oh, no, because that'll be a nearest two thing, isn't it?
Yeah.
Ah, fuck.
What? Right, anyway. Jack, Dundee United ended Rangers' domestic unbeaten run at the weekend, but how many games did the streak last for?
40.
Correct.
Oh, see, that balances out. That balances out.
David, how many cards were awarded in total during the SPFL game week two to the nearest four?
How many cards?
Yeah, the nearest four.
Nearest four.
So there was six games.
Your maths was great in one of the Euros questions.
I'm going to say 15.
Wrong, it was 23. Oh,
Jesus Christ. I went at about
Jack, this is
again.
To equal up, I think, two each, no, isn't it? No. Goal scorer at the weekend, Christian Doidge, was brought through which now Premier League Academy?
Ooh.
Which now Premier League now Academy? Yes. Can I give him a hint?
Please. No, you've already given him a hint.
It's not a big hint.
You already have given him a hint.
That's a question.
The way you said now.
That's a question. It's in capital letters. Can I give him a hint?
Oh, but that's already, you've given
He's
him a hint.
Too competitive, so yes, sorry.
Yeah, you've already given him a hint, have you not?
That's not a question. That's in the question.
I know, but the way you've emphasised now Premier League club has given him a hint.
Not really.
So somebody's come up.
Yeah.
Right.
Most teams have come up behind this, so. There's only like two teams ever that haven't been relegated.
Hearts.
No, he meant English Premier League.
Oh, what?
Oh, right.
Sorry.
I should have probably said that, sorry. That's
so
my
Christian
fault.
Also crilled on a minute here. Let's just rewind. Christian Doidge, who's now playing at Hibs, came to the Hearts Academy.
I'd have been
sorry, Jack. It isn't in the question, so I should have said that it's the English Premier League.
Right, okay. I thought it was top Scottish football, sorry.
I know. Hey, Matthew, that's it. He's came for you, mate.
Sorry,
you
Matthew.
I think that Doidge came to the Hearts Academy.
That was good.
No, that would have been funny, though.
Right, go. Can I give him a hint?
Yeah, go for it.
Very good, Youth Academy. Very good. A lot of big players came out of there. No one at Top Dogs, but obviously.
I'm trying to think who came up this year.
Let's keep a guessing, because we're fucking running out of time.
Brentford?
No.
No.
Southampton?
They just came up?
That wasn't the question. It's now Premier League.
Aye, but the way you gave it, you were fucking...
Ah, but I'm not in charge.
Leading me astray there.
He was.
You said good, I thought Southampton. Right,
so it's still 2-1 to you, games. David?
It is indeed.
Newly promoted side, Celtic Hearts, are currently sitting on how many points in League 2 after the opening Two fixtures?
Six.
Fucking hell, that's a horror question. What, but yes, fuck, it's man. Correct. So, David, you're the winner. But we'll give you the last question anyway. We'll give you it for double points. Why not?
Why not? None of this matters.
Which team has the smallest stadium in the championship in terms of capacity? Oh, that's a good answer.
Arbroath.
I don't know, mate.
No. Morton.
It's not your question, so shut up.
How have I dived in like that? Is it not Arbroath?
It's not Arbroath. It's no Morton.
What the fuck?
But it's Jack's question for double points, so you fucked that.
Can I look at the teams?
Which, oh sorry, there's been a late change to the question. Which newly relegated team that have just went to the championship has surprisingly the smallest capacity for stadiums? Aye, well done. How did you get that answer for that question? That's great. So it's 3-0 going into the tiebreaker. And who's going first?
I don't give a shit, doesn't matter anyway.
Oh, he's raging. And he's raging. Right, it goes to you first then, Jack. How many goals were scored in total in League
How
One?
Does that work?
In League One?
In League One at the weekend. How many goals in total? How many teams are in League One? Just go after that, Mavs.
10 or 12.
How many goals were scored?
He doesn't get a point for that. Can we just be clear?
How many goals were scored? You're first.
So it's five games.
We need to be quick here. Because we're running out of time.
16.
I was going to say 16 as well, so I'll say 17.
It was 17.
Oh. Yay! Oh, what a beauty well, that is.
Your champion, David Buick.
That's enough of that.
The only winner this week.
Yes. Score predictions for Friday.
Oh, shit, last bit. Right, quickly, let's fly through this. Score predictions. Oh, for Friday, I've got predictions for the weekend, I know. Would they,
Dame? No, because we'll do a live show for the weekend.
3-0, right, okay, we'll do that then.
So, predictions for Friday, though?
3-0.
3-0.
Fuck me, I'd take 3-0.
I think we'll be similar. We'll go.
Nah, I'm going to say 5-0. I know we're good up front, but I don't think we'll score more than 5, so 5-0 Dunfermline.
Aye, who's going to score the goals for Dunfermline, Jack?
Todd Ross can score all 5. Oh, sorry, yes, and Jack, all right, he'll...
What's his name?
Graham Dorans.
Graham Dorans, 100%.
You know, the last Graham Dorans played the last time we were at Ibrox. He beat us 6-0. Scored 2 free kicks.
I think Graham Dorans might have a shot in the game, that's better though.
Fucking no chance. He'll have to get, like, move first.
Yeah.
Nah, I'm joking. I'm slagging him off far too much. He wasn't that bad. Everyone was atrocious. He was just atrocious.
Ah, he's just came, not I mean, to the team, so yeah. In his time.
He said himself he was pissed though, so fair play to him.
Did it go to extra time or a replay?
Extra time.
Extra time. Right, we'll call it there, lads. Thanks very much for tuning in to TSF. If
subscribe.
You are new around here, subscribe.
Welcome to all our Japanese fans.
And hello to all Japanese fans. Have you got any finishing words, Jack?
Arigato.
I'm got my bed.
Hey, see you later. Goodbye.